Ron Paul is still exploding. Dr. Paul essentially won the Ames straw poll and more recently took the California straw poll, decisively an important trend indicative of his very good chances at the GOP nomination. Dr. Ron Paul is doing something unheard of in modern United States politics. He is waking Americans up by telling the truth and pointing the finger at the real problems: the banking cartel and their control over our monetary and political system. Dr. Paul offers the best contrast to President Obama for his foreign policy and economic policies, and as we have seen, he has the best chance to gain and beat Obama. Dr. Paul is a self-made man with plenty of experience in United States politics, and he's the only GOP candidate that is not banking cartel-owned, meaning he is the only one we can trust. The corporate fraud media is doing its best to try and suppress Dr. Paul's campaign and his messages. A study from University of Minnesota revealed that Ron Paul has had the lowest amount of television FaceTime amongst the other GOP candidates. CNN did not allow Dr. Paul to make a closing statement at the recent Western Republican Leadership Conference that was broadcasted nationally. After being called on it, former CIA agent Anderson Cooper had to launch into a 6-minute-plus rant trying to discredit the Paul campaign. Even small local media organizations and reporters have had a hand in the predictable nationwide marginalization attack pattern similar to what the dinosaur corporate media is engaging in against Dr. Paul. John Matthews of KSLG recently interviewed Zach Carter and used the usual mainstream media talking points to try and marginalize Dr. Paul's campaign and ideas. Zach Carter, who has helped to organize the Ron Paul Rock the Revolution tour featuring KRS-One, was very much on point and stayed consistent with his support for Dr. Paul. Humboldt local blogger Hank Sims decided to post that KRS-One would not be in attendance at the Eureka venue of the Ron Paul Rock the Revolution tour, with a quite pronounced red X inscribed over the visage of KRS-One. Similar tactics against Dr. Paul's campaign have been perpetrated throughout the country. Even a Young Turks Al-Gar clique had to waste his time attacking Ron Paul over a non-existent controversy over his eyebrows. Most definitely a good use of time for that media outlet, with revolution going on all over the world, right? Ron Paul was at least able to get the message out through corporate media to the Occupy Wall Street protesters for them to push to end the Federal Reserve. Again, the obvious reason that corporate media organizations are not giving Ron Paul a fair shake is because of the fact that their corporate funding and sponsors are specifically against his campaign of truth and sound money being an important part of America's past and future. The New World Order does not want truth seeping into its narrative. That might wake people up even further to their tyranny. Thanks to Dr. Paul for keeping up his fight against the liars behind the Federal Reserve and the international banking cartel, a tool that the corporate fraud media uses against Dr. Paul and his campaign is the fact that most Americans don't understand the importance of the issuance of currency and credit. Most Americans don't understand that a small, efficient federal government is in everyone's best interests. With these two manipulations, the lamestream media can distort people into being against Dr. Paul's revolutionary budget proposal. I'd like to quickly explain some important parts of his budget plan and how they can be safely implemented in the United States of America immediately so that we can start rebuilding this country. To explain the key parts of Dr. Paul's plan, I'd like to start at the fact that this plan would cut the federal budget by $1 trillion in the first year of implementation. Now, people that don't understand how things work may say that is a very risky plan. In reality, the federal budget is much too large and needs to be cut back in order to have the ability to lower taxes and spur economic growth. In reality, without a monolithic federal government, the states would be free to decide how to operate and take care of their constituencies without worrying about federal regulation taking precedent over common sense laws for their respective states. Dr. Paul's plan would also cut 5 executive cabinet positions and departments: the Departments of Education, Energy, Commerce, HUD, and Interior. None of these 5 departments plausibly advances a legitimate constitutional objective of the federal government. As Bruce Fein, senior policy advisor to the Ron Paul Campiarden, points out, advertisement: the Department of Energy obstructs a rational energy market by skewing incentives to favor so-called green technologies. The department's Solyndra debacle is emblematic. The Department of Commerce does nothing the private sector can't do with greater efficiency. The Department of Education has presided over a frightening decline in student achievement as its spending has ballooned. The Department of Housing and Urban Development has given the nation less net housing and development than it would have had without federal government meddling. The demolition of the federally funded Prudhoe public housing project symbolizes HUD's staggering economic waste. The Department of Interior is largely engaged in land management that should be left to the private sector. It was implicated in the infamous Teapot Dome bribery scandal that occasioned the conviction of Interior Secretary Albert Fall. Its assets should be sold at fair market value. The federal government shouldn't be the largest landlord in many Western states. Dr. Paul's budget addressed the most important concern plaguing the federal budget, and that is a military-industrial complex's hold on our spending. We spend tens of billions every year on useless military weapons projects and boondoggles. Underdrive. Paul's plan: we would cut this spending back and start moving things in the right direction against the military-industrial complex as President Eisenhower would have wanted. His budget ends the wars by ending war funding, freezing the spending, and reducing the spending by 15%. These benefits are not frozen or reduced. Dr. Paul's plan would cut all U.S. foreign aid. For some reason, there are those in the United States that still currently believe we can afford to send tens of billions of dollars overseas to fund the governments and militaries of other countries. This is simply not the case when America is falling apart within our own borders. A very important part of Dr. Paul's plan concerns the entitlement programs. Underdrive. Paul's plan: the entitlement programs are not touched, with one important exception. Young workers would be given the option to opt out of them. This is a huge change and frees individuals from imposed government taxation to be able to live as the founding fathers had envisioned, to be able to use their own money as they see fit for their family and community. Dr. Paul's plan also eliminates taxes on the personal savings of Americans so they can start saving for purchases once again. With the size of the federal government reduced and moving in the direction of efficiency, we can lower taxes for all Americans and watch tax receipts explode as they did when JFK implemented across-the-board tax cuts in the wake of the JFK tax cuts phased in from 1962 to 1965. Federal revenues surged at a real rate near 5% per annum. Most importantly, we can create a situation where millions of federal government and military workers would be able to leave government positions and re-enter local communities to start to rebuild America from the bottom up. Local and sustainable food, health, and energy industries are paramount and a first priority necessary in being able to get America back on track. With healthy workers, we can address our education and infrastructure needs. Local, county, and especially monolithic state governments such as California will need to lower the barrier for entry into entrepreneurship greatly, which includes simplifying the business formation process to make entrepreneurship easily attainable for all Americans that want to work hard and to run a business to sustain their families and communities. You can find Dr. Paul's plan here. After reviewing it, it's obvious this plan is the way forward for America. Dr. Paul is also exploding on the national scene with recent campaign ads directly discussing important issues the American people are wanting to talk about. As Drive, Paul indicates during his recent interview with Wolf Blitzer, the ideas he is presenting are important to Americans and to catching on with the American people. Now is the time to decide if we will go forward in the right direction with Dr. Ron Paul as president, or if we are going to let the international banking cartel continue to take this country down a death spiral that we'll never be able to get out of.